Welcome to Harvard Coursera sponsored. Cal Arts USC also getting Coursera credits for film criticism 405. And if you're signed up for semester two, then you're in semester two territory in the right place, because this is our fifth class. If you count the first two as one, because we've met this semester now for almost 5 hours, and I want to thank you all for following me through this. And to get Coursera credit, you have to prove to the computer that you've seen, played through all of the audios or movies of the masterclass that you're taking, and especially if you're getting YouTube masterclass Coursera credits at Harvard particularly, you want to make sure that you get your credits for semester one. And dare we retread on any semester one issues, may them be noted that some of those things need repeated in film history. And one thing about film history is we're looking at it from another angle anyway. I mean, like, I'm not saying that to be, like, cheesy with camera angles and stuff. I mean, like, every time we see the same scene or read about it, we think about it differently, do we not? I mean, is it not the same question the second time? This scene means this. Only that which is set in stone. Like, for instance, it's set in stone that we don't know what the briefcase is in Pulp Fiction, but we all give it a chance because we think, oh, it's an intentional MacGuffin. Well, an intentional MacGuffin draws attention to itself just to deflect the fact that it has any meaning. And that's because an original MacGuffin is something you think has all the meaning, and it keeps your eyes on it and keeps the action moving forward. But really, in the end, it's kind of got this mystery as to what the MacGuffin really is, and that, like, he's pointing to it in Pulp Fiction is already his expression of saying, this is obviously the MacGuffin, and this is a plot technique. And Hitchcock was the one that basically invented that with 39 Steps and even films before that. Also, in matter of aesthetics, we know that's the philosophy of aesthetics, is the philosophy of beauty, or what we like in the art form of drama and theater originally. But there are seven arts. There's theater, there's poetry, there's architecture, there's dance, and that counts with music. There's painting, and then there's the seventh cinema. The seventh is cinema. And then the other one we'd have to go with writing. Writing is the other art. So those are the arts, the art forms that do exist. And we see poetry drawing close to writing, and those two things kind of linking up. Architecture and theater kind of have a same point of view, because there is a set you have to build in film and in architecture that is a design that has to be regulated before you can make the movie. And that's why some movies do claim artifice, even the ones we talked about last masterclass, the Rossellini films. And the neorealism of the Rossellini films really makes you wonder how they shuffle around and move some of the scenography to make way for what their realistic content is towards the movie that they're making, which they're trying to make realistic and using artifice to do it. It's a real fine line. Because really, if you're using cinema verite, you don't have to really change the set you're already in. And that they do that in the Dogma 95. They don't really have to change it from the set they're in with the camera they have, and that it picks up everything anyway, is to the advantage that they're doing it for a movie and they can do natural light, natural settings, natural actors, you know, everything nature. And we do that when we make films, but there are ways of capturing a real big moment on real big film casts that are going to show the whole world either the devastation or the procurement of things gone by, and we'll see how great it is, but yet we'll see how realistic it is when the camera stays on the shot for such a long time. Because the theory goes that when you're imprinting reality, when you start the camera, it starts making an imprint in 24 frames per second or 29 digital. And then in 29 frames per second, it's capturing an imprint of the reality around you. This I'm talking to you right now is coming from a reality around me. You're seeing it a little bit later than I record it. It's coming in a different reality than you have. but mine's the recorded one, so it's like always keeping track of what's going on in front of it, that we have to change that space so often and manipulate that space to make a more continuous movie, that what I'm doing now doesn't really count as a directed movie. And so some would say, well, I'm giving it my all to teach about film. Well, yeah, giving it my all. Well, it's all, everybody does that when they're teaching. I mean, they give the whole point of the story away. And that everything imprints in real time in realistic movies and dogma ways now is because the digital cameras can handle the focus and can handle the technique of capturing those kind of scenes. And that we look at Dogma 95, where it's like Julian Donkey Boy, a movie like that that a lot of people hate and say it's like Kids or any of those other Harmony Korine movies. And that Julian Donkey Boy is a twisted film and it goes in twisted ways, and none of the things about having a twisted plot are really from or against the Dogma series, but that it's like Gummo in its sense of non-stop haberdashery when it compares these like deliverance-like people to their whereabouts. But I'm not going to go on saying it's pro or con anything, because it seems so postmodern that it doesn't seem to take a political stance. A film like Gummo should be observed only by art filmmakers interested in what it can be to lambast and cherish a culture that doesn't exist exactly in that extreme, but would be interesting if it did. And it's kind of anthropological in that sense of, now we found the hotbed of deliverance in our own neighborhood, give us Harmony Korine. But now I want to move on to the movies I was talking about that are realist and have long takes, but they're actually fantasy films, and that they're horror, sci-fi, fantasy is true, that they're, but Swedish style, because we have a film we've talked about a little bit is Vampire. And I don't mean Les Vampires, the French film by Fouillard, but that comes important in long takes. But I mean Vampire, V-A-M-P-Y-R, and it actually was a sound film by the guy we're going to talk about next, and that's Carl Theodor Dreyer. Now that there's a book by Paul Schrader called Transcendental Method and Style in Film that Paul Schrader writes about Carl Dreyer and how he chronicles the narrative of what we will call the other, or the holy other, or God, or the transcendent, that it's not really God, because God is a stable, static, 100% thing. I mean, no one can quite claim God, because only he is the one that, if he existed, he'd be bigger than everything, right? Bigger than me, bigger than you. The whole point of God is that he's bigger than all of us. And I think that's important to note, that like, the, like, wouldn't it be weird if God could probably represent himself as a small thing, but that it's always this bigger thing with God, and that we search even cinema's imprint of reality for that God, for that Messiah in the film. And like, you know, critics like me just have a Messiah complex, because we think if we watch Taxi Driver again, the events will occur, like, just because we're watching it, you know, that's just a paranoia. We don't really think that. That's just something we never tell people, as we think, oh, what if this came true right at the time I was watching this, you know? And I won't get into that too much here, but I will say the imprint of reality speech is interesting, because we do have a say in what makes us realize that we're watching something quality made, or we're watching something that hasn't been made up to the tradition of quality, but that can very well be a stylistic pin mark of the camera to make a documentary of reality, but still use it in a narrative film, which is why I commended Rossellini, because his films were neorealist, but they were also fictitious stories, just like Antonioni. Or this is Carl Dreyer, and the first film we're going to discuss is Day of Wrath. We discussed Vampire. It's the one where they copy in a lot of the Dracula movies with Christopher Lee. The original 1930s sound one by Dreyer is the one where the guy rents a room in a hotel, like Fearless Vampire Killer style later. He rents a room in a hotel and everything starts getting weird, and you start seeing this figures of death and vampires and like dark fishermen, you know. I've based movies on Carl Theodor Dreyer's Vampire. I did one called Orgy of the Damned that kind of had the vampire script going for it at first, and My script's available to read online, and I'm only promoting my own stuff, not to really get into it theoretically, because it isn't the most excellent news to the cinema. It's just a kind of a footnote, but that it was made after Vampire is solid, because Vampire had such impressionistic-expressionistic style hybrid that it's hard to say whether Dreyer was really going for the other or was talking about a typified Dracula persona of the vampire who was the Nosferatu, who he did teach to slay, which comes out later in like video games like Castlevania 2, where you see how to slay Dracula. It's the same as Carl Dreyer's vampire. This movie is more important, I think, to draw from, and we will one day cover The Passion of Joan of Arc and its expression impression. But Day of Wrath's one that starts to get interesting, because he starts to film it more realistically, and we all look at that clip out front and we think, it looks like a witch burning on a cross, which is exactly what it is. And this is a weird movie because, unlike Salem's Lot or unlike the Salem Witch Trials and the Crucible and everything, the witches in this are all actually ratting each other out, and that like they all pretend to be Christian women married to this Christian priest, but they're just a witch cult that's come to kill them. Isn't so surprising that the witches are putting each other to death, condemning them as being witches and not within the Christian faith. So this one's got a little bit of a twist to it, because when a witch puts another witch to death, not only is it a sign that like the other witch is submissive to her and has already won the battle because they couldn't pay him back for something or whatever reason, that there's these interesting things about Day of Wrath that I've never thought about. For one thing, at the end of the movie, sort of, they kind of look through his hymn book and sing the song Day of Wrath. Now, the song Day of Wrath is haunting and plays for a part of this movie in chorus, and you're thinking to yourself, that's the song that the witches sing? And that, like, these lyrics are so incendiary that they're singing in Day of Wrath, but it's their normal hymn book, and that they're thinking these are either Christian or Satan songs doesn't really change the fact that they were written at a time that you could blend your paganism with your Christianity, and there are still times like that, although I haven't really found many places where they blend Christianity and pagantry together. I have seen it done, but Day of Wrath, it didn't work out for the pagans or the Christians, because all the witches are putting each other to death and confessing to be witches. That there's a long scene that was almost like she was really burned at the stake isn't what makes this transcendent. The way he edits with long takes and long drawn-out scenes that when you've seen them the second time, they're different because then you know who the witches are. And I kind of gave you a spoiler that all the females pretty much that are in the lead in this movie are witches. From the nanny to this lady they sacrifice to the younger girl. And there's other witches too, but you don't know they're all witches until you get to the end, and that Day of Wrath is coming for the lead witch. Isn't just that she already knew it was coming, but that she accused the other witch of being witchery and almost put her on the stake instead. Makes this one a good switch around, but it also leans towards the fact that the evil one is something that these witches believe in, and that's a significant holy other or unholy other in this case. That the unholy other is still another transcendent of our realm before us, that we'd have to do something to come in communique with the holy other is true, like some kind of meditation, mediation, sometime of like someone that's, or even in this witchcraft case, a necromancy, where they're bringing back people from the dead to recall stories of what the evil one put them through. That something changes in the bishop when he realizes his young wife wants to be with him forever and is convincing him of her Christianity, and that she's doing this mainly because preachers in Denmark and in Sweden and in other places, Finland, are maybe not so much in Finland, but preachers and priests and high priests are all paid a lot more in those in Scandinavian countries, not just because of their socialism and their income, it's because the government supplies social funding to the church, that the church isn't in charge of making funds for the army like the Japanese Church of Buddhism is, but that actually the state gives it all to the church so that they can run a Christian scene. And that the Middle Ages came a time where there was all these witch clearances. And I think it's interesting that the movie Hexen by Benjamin Christensen from Sweden and Denmark from years earlier had viewed the same kind of thing of like witches burning witches, but not even in a festival, but not even in malice. But like, then there's things like wolfhounds that invade a church, or like they'll have these stale guards, or like this Hexen movie shows that all. I mean, there's demons that like come after women in their sleep. I mean, there's like witches that, like, I don't know, this is a Halloween episode, right? Because I'm gonna say witches that fly around phantasmagoria style. It's that scene that they even used in Avenging Conscience first by Griffith, and we know that scene's been used before to connote mystery science horror theater, you know. And so we've seen that skeleton on the bike before, but Dave Rath uses a realistic approach. Like, if that were a realistic story about witches condemning each other to burn at the cross, I could see why it was filmed so realistically instead of using the fantasy interjection, because that way you're more concerned about the human interest of the fact that these might be witches, but that they're personified as human, and therefore they're either in touch with the Holy Other or coming into touch with the Holy Other, and that's how you grant a film like this in a special case of transcendent, that the frames themselves come together in such a way that they leave impressions of what the rest of the picture is going to be outside the frame is so variably true that all you see is an imprint of the reality that they had to build as artifice in the film, that they're making an imprint of the set of the film as well as the character of the film is somewhat of a classical setup, unavoidable, but that the logic of the film is interminably unique is one way we credential Day of Wrath. And I think that really, if it has its own psalm-like hymn that already occurs, like what the film was about, then I'm into you, Dreyer. And Dreyer, that's three good for him now we've talked about. We talked about his film The President in Masterclass last time, and it's kind of like this guy who becomes a Freemason, devil worshiper, but Christian kind of guy, you know. At the end of the movie, he becomes the president because he gets picked. But he's like this, he lives by the rules, dies by the rules, doesn't mind the social government, becomes the head of the social government at the end just by walking around and checking his watch a few times and walking in and signing the paperwork. So this was Dreyer started out without transcendence as his medium. By the time we get the Passion of Joan of Arc, past Leave of Satan's book, for instance, Passion of Joan of Arc constructs the whole theater of both absurd and reality that Renee Falconetti is realistic as Joan of Arc and plays the character so realistic that it doesn't phase out in Godard's movie, My Life to Live, where the main character is Jean, and it wasn't Jean Moreau, it was in My Life to Live with Anna Karina. You get this scene of the Passion of Joan of Arc playing across the screen, and it's in mute, and you think she's going to talk, and the whole scene's in mute by Godard, and it still shows the Renee Falconetti looking so beautiful that Dreyer would have been so proud that he had Anna Karina watching Renee Falconetti in a scene that shows before all film buffs as this crowning achievement of the woman who went to go watch the movie about the movie that they're making now in the streets of France. But these, strangely enough, are Denmark films. Now, Denmark films, I don't know much about the industry other than it's socialized, so it's rare to get a filmmaker out the door, let alone a world-class, world-known filmmaker as Dreyer. The Dreyer was considered auteur by even Bazin and other theorists is a fact that we can extend to his skill as a director. The Leaves from Satan book, in fact, have four stories of people struggling and falling under the temptation of going with the sell their soul route. And then by the time they've gotten back what they needed and loved and lost, they lost it again because the devil took everything. And really, it's one of those stories, but it's also got things in it like flying on a flying carpet and things like Destiny would have with Fritz Lang. And that kind of reminds me of like a video game or something, you know, like those Thief of Baghdad movies totally remind me of like a Mario game where he's like, but he's really doing these mind-numbing special effect stuntman work. And you're thinking, well, it still is filmed from the side, and I'm used to playing video games from the side, you know. And I only mention that in Master Clash to remind us that they kind of knew that to make it, like, entertaining, it makes it look like you're making a guy jump up there by just thinking so hard that's what he's going to do, and the camera shot is set up to make you think that. And I seriously know that's a psychological effect of the film. This is another film by Carl Dreyer. It's the second one we're going to talk about other than Vampyr and some of his earlier ones. And this is Odette, and I've seen all of Dreyer's movies, and I love them all. This was probably after Passion of Joan of Arc and Day of Wrath. This is my next favorite, is Odette. And a lot of people have this on kind of a memory plan. Like, I remember the first time I saw this, the first half I saw at the CalArts Film School, the film library, and I was watching, like, some Stan Brakhage, and I decided to watch Odette, and I only had an hour, and I watched about 30, 40 minutes of it. And at the beginning, there's this guy, he's praising the Lord, his God, but he himself is slowly professing to be God, or at least like the persona of Jesus, who was this savior of all, but he's saying he's Jesus. So now he's got a messiah complex, and it's internalized, and the weirdest thing is everyone accepts him just as this kind of mentally ill guy who has schizophrenia, and he's running around the hills, and no one knows why he does it, but at least he's praying to God, and that's something we encourage in our society. But that he's saying he is God and Jesus is kind of getting on everybody's nerves, because they worship a God and that has Jesus as his son, but they don't think it's him for one thing, because how could it be him? Because they're not special, they're not holy, and they don't think he's special or holy, but that the fact he says he is and he thinks he is almost chaotic, the way the characters look at him in reality and say, and decharge all special effects about the guy and say he probably isn't the Messiah, but at least he's thinking well. And this all gets really contained in another plot where one of the women is now starting to die, and as she's dying, as the film progresses towards its illusory ending, she's dying, and the only person that can bring her back is the dude with the Messiah complex. Now he comes back in the room and gives a total faith healing speech, and everybody else was watching her die, and the brother's getting really mad because now he really doesn't believe he's the Messiah, and wouldn't you love it, but the transcendent other comes in and we don't see it, but her eyes open back up, she's well, she's made whole. The faith healing of this guy who's thought to be schizophrenic, bipolar, actually turns out to be enough to heal her, whether he was the Messiah or not. He brought her back from the dead, she resurrected, and they still don't know whether to believe that he's a Messiah or not, but they know he had healing power, and it was the thought that counted. Like the Bible says, the intentions of the heart are what matter in the situation of action. And we have the case of guy who's deliriously out in the hills praising God's name and giving sermons to the sheep, you know. And then he's giving sermons to the sheep. People in the theater with Dreyer are like, well, is he condemning the church or saving it? And that's so funny. He has such a retaliation against the church in Joan of Arc and Leaves of Satan book that you're going, and, you know, the church is totally despised in Hex, and that's not Dreyer, but Vampyr. You know, it never occurs to anyone in Vampyr that the church can actually help them with vampires. They think the church is just one big Vampyr outlet where they pretend to let them come and then they either torture them or spare them or let them torture them. I don't know. He just has this full frontal toward it, like this wouldn't exist without the church's, you know, superstition and all that. But the supernatural form doesn't exactly film onto camera without special effects. And we all know the special effects, Schrader argues, of Charlton Heston Christian films is that, like, they're so pronounced that they're heavy-handed, that they're Hollywoodized, that it probably wouldn't look like that if you filmed a miracle. But we've got to understand these films are staged, and that they did put up the order and species of how they made forward on these Dreyer movies, and that Dreyer's only making one film per decade, and now he's up to the 1950s with Odette, 1940s with Day of Wrath, 1930s with Vampyr. his films only come out once a decade. They're like Stanley Kubrick. There's not a whole lot of them to see them all. I've mentioned all of them, but like three or four right now. And I'm going to go to the last one in a minute, but we've got to talk more about Odette. That this couple on the cover is the one in love, and he's going to miss his wife, and he only thinks it's worse that his brother, when she died, his brother was still insane with a messiah complex and his schizophrenia. Now, the movie never reveals if he doesn't have a psychological complex or not, but is pretty sure that he does, because he's told to stop acting like Jesus several times and just gets more acting like Jesus. And I'm not talking about like Peter O'Toole in The Ruling Class. I'm talking about a guy that's full-on concerned that in 3 days he'll get crucified and in 3 days he'll rise again, which everybody knows is someone that's totally going on some martyr mission and they don't even have to. So I think it's kind of funny in a way. The beginning of this movie starts and you see the messiah complex guy kind of out there like drilling one to all of nature, you know, to come ye and listen, you know. You read the subtitles, and I just want to say, for masterclass level, you have to be able to read subtitles. I mean, all these movies have English subtitles. I'm not asking you to speak in the original language of the films you find. That we focus on foreign films is mainly because, not just because we can find a richer text, but we can take examples from a text that we don't always see we're used to having. And that we can go to other movies besides the typical ones that we go to for entertainment, like The Matrix and Star Wars, which I love, and we'll have masterclasses on them. Which we already had a masterclass on Star Wars, and I already got all into the Japanese and how they call samurai Jedi and all that. We've talked about that, you know. But in a way, it's funny because I feel like the guy from Odette, where he's out in this field preaching to no man's land. Sometimes that's how this class feels on a weird level, because I have like appointed myself a position that the higher up positions have said, go ahead and keep doing what you're doing. But if it fell through and, you know, I had forgotten that there were movies in America, in Hollywood, with Anne Bancroft, like The Graduate, that do the things that, like, Day of Wrath do with camera work, but don't have the supernatural. But Odette clearly shows that the supernatural within Dreyer is realistically shown, only in the sake that, like when Joan of Arc repents that it was her that heard the voice that killed the army, that saved the French, that was the voice of God. But that's why she's facing torture again, is because she reconfessed after trying to get out of it once. And that she reconfessed is her demise. That's the moment of transcendence, is when she knows that pain and suffering will end in death. And that's the scene they show in My Life to Live in the theater, that pain and suffering lead to death. And to whose death? My death, she says. And the Inquisitor is a character in Joan of Arc that you can't deny is somewhat the most evil thing you'd confiscate. So maybe on one side it's saying Joan should be the ordinance of the church, not the church acting like these characters that did during Christ's crucifixion. And I'm not going to get too preachy, but that's exactly what I'm saying. It's like Dreyer doesn't get too preachy when the woman comes back to life after the guy with the messiah complex prays for her. It's totally wild, because it could have been the power of suggestion just in the room that brought her back. And sometimes people say, well, that's what prayer is power of suggestion. And I'm not going to get into how I think prayer is kind of old, outdated, because really it's just slowing you down, because really it's organizing your thoughts in a way. But like that it wishes for good vibes, yeah. But the thing is that you're talking to something that may not be there. It's probably something that should be held in. And I talk to myself enough as it is, so I'm not saying anyone who prays is talking to themselves. But it kind of throws a monkey wrench into the theory that he's not Jesus, because he brings him back from the dead. They'll doubt him, and then all of a sudden he's like, well, my work here is done, you know. He's like, I'll go help someone else now. And then at the same time, you're wondering if he's talking to himself like they are, like they're telling him not to, and that they're not crazy at all, even in the end of their lives, is interesting, because the woman that dies, you can tell, isn't crazy, but the guy who's praying that brings her back to life makes it twisted in a way like Day of Wrath makes it an irony. This is why I'm searching for the other in this message, because the irony is that now that the guy that prayed for knows he's Jesus, how are they going to tell him that he's not when they realize that even though his prayer brought her back from the dead? So his prayer brought her back from the dead, but the ultimate truth is he may be this Rue of Count, the countenance of Rueful, you know, this Don Quixote character that comes back to life, you know. And I like that he is Don Quixote, and you never know if he is who he says he is, but in Don Quixote, you know that he's not who he says he is. In Ordet, you know, he might be who he says he is, but probably isn't. But that he has the power of resurrection, just on his belief in that, makes the spectator wonder, should it be better to be crazy so you can be more spiritual? Which is exactly what Dreyer's saying, is the irony is that it isn't spiritual because he is crazy and can't receive that. And the Day of Wrath kind of states the same thing, is that even if it is the Holy Other, the witches cannot receive that because it is not unto them to be holy unto the nature of that which does not exist, which is God anyway. So that we see these wrathful rebellions in these interpreted dilemmas of Carl Dreyer, and his not only transcendent but ironic modern and long takes and deep full focus and all of these amazing costumes that take you to Denmark history, and that they're all set in the past, the Middle Ages with Days of Wrath and the modern time with Ordet, and that the modern time shows such a bleak look on God, and how God has left them all behind, and how he's wrathed upon them, and how he's given them hell to each other, and that he's condemned them to witchcraft. And it's everything that Kierkegaard wrote about and more, how when you're a Christian you have to pick up your cross and get self-flagellation, and external flagellation is coming at you, and all that. There's some ruckus of some guy that believes in God that everyone thinks is sinking the boat, and probably would have anyway. But just his delicate care enough for the woman to pray for her to come back, which is already something some people might have tried in their life and failed at and didn't think that was a bad thing, because at least they tried. And I don't want to get into all ethics and superstitions of prayer, but is it okay to pray for someone to come back to life at all? And that had she not, what would have been the outcome? We would have been all well. We all knew he was just hopeful that she would come back, and that he thinks he's Jesus. Doesn't really punish him any more than we're going to. But they are at this point looking for some kind of punitive means to handle their brother until he gets out of any conflict resolution by somehow praying her back awake, and that she wakes up after being dead for what the film says to be 10-20 minutes doesn't mean that Jesus is going to give up. And the weird thing about it is in the New Testament there's not much doubt when Jesus is doing a miracle that they're seeing Jesus do it, until later after they crucify him, and then they try to cover it all up. And I'm just saying that in this one, the Messiah guy, the Messiah complex guy, does really know he is who he is, has no doubts in his mind that he's Jesus, but that he would have to die on the cross, he's already telling the audience, and that he prayed for the woman to come back, and that was the only prayer he'd prayed so far. And now he's out of the woods because she came back to life. Does not mean that Christ would have turned back time to save someone, except in his own command of doing the Lord's will. And I think it's really hard to understand about why you could then see that Messiah complex of applying to Jesus. And that's what I'm getting at, himself. Because even in these epic movies describing Jesus, the personification of God is already going to be pretty hard. Now that they've gotten it right with Gospel of St. Matthew, and everything is good that they've personified as human is great. But Jesus himself, even in the movies as an actor or whatever, and even in the book, could have had a himself complex. You know, he could have actually been talking to himself, thinking he was seeing things, writing down what he was seeing. And if they're all writing it down, is all how Jesus came to be in his superpower. But that there's ever a doubt that that superpower could work, he's not just going to come back as someone that heals someone, and that was his whole point of coming back. Or would he, just to save one woman from dying, he'd come back as Jesus in another form, and that some of the original doubters of him thought that he had a mental illness. His disciples and the chroniclers never thought Jesus had a mental illness and did say he could bring people back, and it was great faith that he could, which in the scene where the Messiah guy is praying, you're not really getting this whole chance that he's going to win this one. You're kind of worried when you see him pray. You kind of want to make him stop praying. And the irony is, his prayer comes true, and they're still like, ah, we still should have made him stop praying. And who's to know? They might be right. Maybe they should have had him stop praying. I don't know, but the point is that, like, it's a twisted irony that goes double backing on itself in its own binary opposite. By the time you get the whole form and content of impressionism and expressionism, impressionistic in lighting, expressionistic in zigzag design of set, chiaroscuro lighting. Speaking of chiaroscuro lighting, where it's like a lighting with shadows, and that everything comes out of the shadow, and Gertrude is a really underrated film by Carl Dreyer. It's 1960s. And then it's another transcendent film. I do see this one as actually being kind of the female melodrama Dreyer, because Dreyer did one called Master of the House that I have somewhere around here, and it's a 1925 domestic melodrama, and then it's filmed in these boxes, and then each box is kind of part of a big cube and game that you can go through and select which box you want to go into and see how it's moving and see how it's different. It's kind of the story of this guy who is kind of in his later days, and he is mean to his wife because she doesn't get everything done, and he tells her she's useless and that he can do everything, so she leaves, and he has to do all the housework as well as his own work, and then by the end he invites her back and tells her he's sorry. And it's so claustrophobic to be only in the room, and it's this idea that you're still in the room by the end of the film. Or Gertrude's like an exterior of that, because actually now you're having these Antonioni moments where everything's outdoors and you're filming on these kind of sets that are like gardens and nature and beautiful. And for once, it's not quenched like Day of Wrath and Ordet in these surroundings of total, you know, asceticism, or these surroundings of non-material, that they're just these no set to the movie, you know, that they're building these lights and sets in the movie is interesting because they're as intricate as Cocteau's Beauty and the Beast, for instance. But that they're actually muting the settings comes true in Gertrude, where she has her flashbacks or flash forwards, whichever way you deem to set it. Just sometime at the storyline that wasn't in the time where she was telling or having the story or the flashback. Which makes me think this film kind of reminds me of how they made Marnie with Tippi Hedren by Alfred Hitchcock, and how that film came out with her flashbacks that were actually her PTSD and did make her flashback like that. That the flashbacks are filmed in a vertigo, push forward, rack back, and put rack forward, push back, etc. The Marnie flick has a few clicks of the frame that comes in, vamping its style. Now, The Lady Vanishes has this whole testament of what happens to a character when they're lost in the movie before La Aventura. Because remember last time we talked about La Aventura and what would happen if a character was walking along and got swept into a film and you didn't see her anymore. And that's what happens to Monica Vitti in La Aventura. She walks through the frame set and you don't see her the rest of the time. Lady Vanishes has one like that at the beginning of the movie. You might have seen the woman, and then she disappears for the rest of the time. And now it's like one of those rope type things where the body's nearby, but they don't know where it is. Nobody in the movie knows where it is. Now you're on a train, and you're stuck in this claustrophobic ordination. But Gertrude is not really playing off of that, or Marnie, which is still around the same time as Gertrude actually being made, and a little after, though. And Gertrude comes in with this hard reality of why black and white is still, though it is the lesser of the medium now that we're into the 60s, and here comes 1967 with The Graduate and Bonnie and Clyde, and now every movie has to be in color because of those films. Like, even Hard Day's Night, you got to realize, which is the film that modernized the cinema, and Psycho by Hitchcock that modernized the cinema, that it was the realism of Gertrude and the modernism of that that Paul Schrader was claiming on as the transcendent mode. As these other films set the table for existentialism like Psycho did. Psycho's cosmic indifference, where a woman gets killed before she can return money she stole, is so accidental and coincidental that it becomes another MacGuffin of the plot to see what would come of the woman's fate had she not been killed. She would have returned the money, she would have gone to jail, she would have faced some consequences, but she'd still be alive, and that her killer comes to get her, and that they're even talking about how that was karmic justice and everything, and how it has nothing to do with karma, is exactly what I'm talking about with existentialism taking the edge. And so now that we're talking about Dreyer as existentialist, we're thinking that the supernatural and machinations of the afterlife aren't really accounted for in these films, though we don't really see the symbolic representation of the holy other in these films, is because they are transcendent and are showing us that can't be filmed the holy other, or it would be nothing but static. Like I said, it would be 100% something or 0% nothing, which are realms we can't get to. We saw with quantum physics, we can't get to absolute zero and we can't get to absolute 100%, but the number the closest to each of those is the biggest number you can reach. Then we'd have a number with about 40,000 decimal points off of it as humankind. But that we need a computer that goes on nearly infinite means we have to imply there is an infinite that it goes on to. That Gertrude does discuss a little bit of the existential vein of these modernist movies that are coming about, and that by Graduate and Bonnie and Clyde, the existentialism in those films with cosmic indifferences, infinitude. But here with the female melodrama, and like we brought up, that melodrama is even the genre of Audette, which actually falls in the category of family melodrama, or male melodrama, but definitely a melodrama. Indeed, that he's been doing that, Dreyer, with his films all along, is totally respected. And that here it's female, talking to her three favorite boyfriends, and that they're each a different guy, and that she likes them all in different ways, is actually kind of a feminist point I had to hand out before I took off early at the end of this class. No, I'm kidding. We're going through time. So this woman, she has to see all her three lovers. Now that she makes it with all three of her lovers would be a more contemporary way of framing this whole story, that it looks like she's going to maybe one of the transcendent moments, because she's kind of finding God and finding these men, and that these men in her life are all equally important to her. And what she doesn't say, that she implies, is that she needs all three for a fulfilled life, so she just won't tell them all about each other. That they kind of suspect each other because they trade off in position isn't that they've conspired and gotten together and that they're all on her side. It's just that they all three think they're the meaning of her life, and she thinks they're the meaning of her life, and nothing is resolved front or in media res or back in media res. In this film, nothing's resolved. It's just her explaining to her men that she loves all three of them. And in different context, she doesn't want to lose any of them. And in the same context, she wants them all to be a secret from each other. And that one of them may actually be one that she loves more is never known. That she needs them all is a hinted fact. That this film is probably another, like Joan of Arc, martyr feminist film. Although Gertrude doesn't die in this one, she does die of herself, like Cleo from 5 to 7, the French New Wave film. And in that sense, she goes from classy back to a regular class, which is the feminine class, which in her sense of Denmark, as we've seen from Master of the House by Dreyer himself, or Vampire, the view of women isn't exactly your most favorite view of women. That the view of women is plain and regular in most of these movies isn't to say that they're played down undervalued feminism. It's to say that their normal, everyday type acting that they're looking for in these kind of existential movies is with these women, whether they're stars or not, in these films, where their looks are only now upplayed in Gertrude and before done in a stale, melodramatic, anti-feminist kind of way. Because Master of the House, while it struggles to reveal its style, still brings attention to the woman is trapped theory, because she's going to go back to him even though she says she's going to spend some time away. That she does follow her word and goes through isn't the most exciting thing about how she'll be taking back over as Master of the House again and have to get everything done. And he'll probably complain again and they'll start the whole thing over. Gertrude is feminist. It takes her as the subjective and the men as the objective. Now, where in the film do you see that? Where it's from the female perspective and the men are in her objective perception. The men are objects and the women are subjects in this film, but that's actually true, and it's the secret of why this film is so loved, even though nothing happens in it with some lady in different scenarios, scenographies that are really beautiful, like at a lamppost. She talks to her men in such a way that she loves them, but they are objectified by having to be handsome, rich, powerful, things she wants in a man that will help her get status, as well as the fact that she already has status. That there is Jean Dielman and there is Woman Under the Influence, and there are some Joan of Arc movies where the keen influence is the subject as the woman and object is the man, is not often the case. And in fact, in Hollywood classical cinema, which all of these films do in their expressionist, impressionist way, have something that Hollywood doesn't have. And while they don't have the flamboyant special effects, they've got the interior dialogue ready to burst forward, and everything that's spoken is coming off this bric-a-brac of this interior monologue that they're all sharing somehow, this social design that we all believe in our country, but it doesn't fail us, it doesn't but prove to fail us in religious matters. That in Gertrude there is even a little bit of that religious matter, and it reminds me of French films and how they have the female and Corinna in A Woman as a Woman also be both subject and object. But I was trying to think of a film, Earrings of Madame D by Max O'Fool, also does show where the men can be objectified, but that the men come back in power in Earrings of Madame D, but in Gertrude, that the lady that plays Gertrude, which was a famous actress in Denmark, and that she had power and had men like that, was kind of a true story. And Day of Wrath and Ordet really weren't true stories. I don't know if Dreyer's joke about Ordet was as well. It couldn't have been based on a true story, but it was. And that no coincidence of someone praying has ever really brought someone back is probably the more true story on that. But then it kind of does that as an irony. Well, it worked this once, and it probably shouldn't have, but there you go. Now the Messiah complex is going to rape John, you know? It's like, well, now we're all in trouble telling him he's not Jesus. And this one, it's just a woman telling telling to her guys that she needs them. In an order that doesn't offend the guys, in a way that says she needs them young, needs them middle-aged, needs them a little older, and she's like, she plays the Three Bears sketch out nicely when she chooses them all, tells them all that they've got to stay with her. They all agree, and she doesn't have to leave anyone, and the look of melancholy on her face on the box is the melancholy she still has. Now tell me, where did I miss the transcendent in this? Now I understand that we're talking about Joan of Arc and Vampire, maybe even a supernatural or transcendent, but these movies seem more psychological and more in a Kubrickian irony, or like in a auteur irony, that the director is just going to use stylization and expressive stylization to put together these worlds and make these worlds realistic, even though they're kind of impressionistically modern and small sets and small lights, that we're going to blow some scenes out of proportion that are kind of the metaphysical metaphors of the film that are kind of outside the film but are in it, but never really cut to any of that in Dreyer. Except in Vampire, when there's all these subjective images and objective images of things that go bump in the night and things that possess the grounds of Denmark, and how this vampire is getting ready to rise from the ashes, you know. The Dryer does these good spectator sports with Ordette just at the beginning of the Messiah, the guy that thinks he's the Messiah, like an actor playing the Messiah, right? An actor playing an actor playing the Messiah. And he's standing there and he's praying over these sheep. You think you'll never see anything more beautiful than him on that hill than the fence. Knowing he's crazy from the first five frames, you're already thinking this guy is so crazy for being out there. But then you're like, but does the film really negate him as a human just because he's mentally ill? And the Day of Wrath has such a discussion of mental illness in it because of the possibility of someone marrying someone that might be a witch is a mentally ill thing by the dementia time of the Middle Ages understanding of witchcraft. And that there is prayer in Day of Wrath that goes for and against the witches and doesn't really have much to do with Christianity is the noted point that Ordette is the one that preaches all the Christian scripture in a nauseating, insane way, and then wins out in the end as being the way that brought her back to life, even though her coming back to life is most likely coincidence, or would have to be coincidence, because who knows of a voice command that can bring someone back from the dead, and would someone want a voice command to bring them back from the dead, even if it's the last thing they ask for on their deathbed? I don't know. I'm not sure about that, but I do think it's kind of the moment of otherness of Christianity we're all looking forward to in the films, Fear and Trembling, Sickness Unto Death, you know, the more flagellation and self-flagellation on the way to the final goal, the more challenging it is, the more obstructed it is, the more convenient it is when it works out, because we may have to be called upon God to go insane for him and think that we're him. Is not normal in society, is actually punished in most societies, and was going to be punished unto him, still might, even though he prayed her back to life. And that goes for God's faith, really, in that term, because who would have faith in God just because some village idiot's prayer brought someone back to life? That's not really a miracle. It's a coincidence. And are all things coincidences? That of miracles is really being played on the spot, that faith, which the guy still has, whether he turns out to be Jesus or not, which he definitely doesn't seem that way, the faith that he's holding on to is like that of Bresson's Diary of a Country Priest, where even in the midst of it, where no one's coming to his sermons, or no one's coming to his masses, or no one's coming to his confession, and no one's coming to his house except for a couple of people, he still believes, even though the odds are against it, and he's dying of wine and bread. Now that Ordette has the same kind of Messiah complex that tortures him until he does see her come back to life, doesn't change that they may have him thrown to the dogs if he keeps up the Messiah complex. That Ordette I could see being transcendental, like Joan of Arc about Dryer. That the other ones are more like a play on impressionistic and expressionistic melodrama. Like I said, with the zigzag sets, like the fences and the chiaroscuro lighting with everything up in the shadow. And Gertrude does a good job of chiaroscuro in it. She's even leaning toward the femme fatale range, not really. She just has a lot of different suitors. And I think the movie makes a good point, Gertrude, that she can have a lot of suitors, and we don't have to judge her for that. We don't have to judge her for that because we don't really think it's a bad thing that she's got three boyfriends just by watching the movie and that she's talking to each of them and that she's sincere to all of them. I mean, she can handle being with all of them. And nobody's arguing in this society that's not even feminist. And now here's this offensively feminist movie that's totally conjuring this message that it's okay for a Denmark lady, especially if she's like a superstar of the theater, right? Which she plays one in the movie because she is one, you know, always, that you're non-professional playing yourself. And that she's also a star of the Denmark screen is also kind of connoted with some of the ways they're setting up the lighting to be superstar. But it's not even a love triangle. It's that she is in love with three different men. And that's quite a triangle because they don't know each other. They've never really heard of each other. If they had, they'd probably be okay with each other because she's just that bomb of a chick to want to be with. Even if she's with two other guys, I don't think any of them would have fought, but she likes to keep them secret because she's into that, and that's the way she enjoys her life, is to keep them secrets unto each other. That Gertrude has nothing but appeal toward that, although there is a bit of melancholy as to whether she maybe should have chosen one over the other. I thank you for sitting by and listening to more of this masterclass. I know we didn't reach much of a conclusion with Dreyer's auteur style because we weren't sure if it was transcendent or modernist irony. Modernist irony is what I'm looking at because of the cosmic indifference of the witches burning each other in Day of Wrath, because of the cosmic indifference of the Messiah complex and the guy that has it, and because of the complications it has to being three different men in it, when the rule book seems to be moderation of one person per one person can be consensual only that it's the irony or cosmic indifference, which just basically means like if there is a God, he's not going to do anything about the bad news or good news. God, if there's good news, like the lady coming back to life, we immediately think, wow, maybe he was God. But actually the bitter irony of the film is that they're all going to go back to being the way they were, and he'll still be thinking he's Jesus on a mission, even though they'll be trying to convince him now that even if he was, he finished his mission, and the guy, you know, it'll just go on as this Messiah complex in this kind of cosmic indifference, because God's not going to change the fact that this guy's mentally ill. And we all know that's what saves this movie in the psychological community, because God cannot stop mental illness, or will not, or does not, but probably will not, because that just seems mean. If mental illness was something that someone struggled with. And then Gertrude, you know, it's cosmic indifference, because if she's with three guys, she doesn't have to answer to God, but that she has to answer to herself is something that brings her pause each time before she goes into a different story. So, I'm going to leave you with that. I think we've discussed Gertrude enough that the cosmic indifference of Dreyer is pretty much what you're looking at throughout all his films, like Vampire and Joan of Arc. It's kind of what really makes him a different kind of director than others, that cosmic indifference does point to the fact that there could be an other through its lack of existence. You could see its binary existing. And that cosmic indifference is a technique that Hitchcock usually uses, but that Hitchcock is like Dreyer in that there's an apocalyptic finale. And Joan of Arc has the apocalyptic finale that kind of was the one that elected Hitch later on to have his finales be apocalyptic. But Day of Wrath, it has an apocalyptic ending. Odette, surprisingly, the dead rise, so could be apocalyptic just to think someone's rising from the dead, even. And that Gertrude, there's really only the outlook of the modern age for tomorrow, because she's happy with her three dudes, even though it brings her to points of kind of confusion and needing clarity from God as to what to do in the situation. And the cosmic indifference comes again as not telling her what to do. And that if there was a God, he would have altered these situations in any way for them to work out. That's why Dreyer is God and taking over and messing them all up. And so that's where I'll leave you on the page of Dreyer's signature technique, his whole gauntlet that you have to run when you're watching his movies, is that it's going to be so religious that it's a-religious. It's going to be so political that it's anarchy, and so psychological that you just have to turn off your sensory perception for a while and organize yourself as your soul floats through the movie. And then everything will be negated as non-metaphysical, and by some point in the film we'll learn that the supernatural is superstitious, and then we'll be taken down by cosmic indifference, that whether there was a God or not, it wouldn't matter, because all these random chaotic things happen in our lives that take out nature's order anyway. Nature's order was never followed, and that's why nature's order breaks down. And even in a terminology of witches that search for the Dark Lord, who is the Great One in their eyes, are still only romancing the subject that there could be some entity more powerful than anything, and yet that there aren't other entities on other sides of beliefs that believe it. Now we're questioning it, so it can't be God, because God can't be questioned. And here we go with Denmark theology. And if you don't think Kierkegaard's going to step in and say, like, bear your cross, you know, become a witch if you have to, you know, do whatever technique the world tells you to do, And if your teacher tells you to do something, do it, you know, and it's like, be a Christian, but, you know, it's a hard one, and fear and trembling before the throne and sickness unto death, that the worse we get toward the end, the better off it'll be to go to nothingness, because then we won't have pain, is all in the cosmic indifference I'm kind of talking about in Dreyer. But that Dreyer revels in it is cinema for the sake of cinema, because reveling in religious heresy is already impossible in a film that takes away and impressionistically organizes the religion around smaller pieces. And that the religion is organized around smaller pieces, it's an impressionism of the fact that they're not even talking about religion in the movie, or the transcendent, maybe, although Schrader's argument isn't infallible. But hear me out, the Carl Dreyer's affectation for the cosmic indifferent at God, whether he existed or not, that's like saying he could have, right? But that's where you get the transcendent, but that he may not have affected the situation any different. It's kind of that irony that so it went the way it did, regardless of nature's selection. And that's just the card that we drew, so we have to take it. So, that's what I'm asking about Dreyer. Do you think that he's leaving enough room that it could have been God in all these movies that was saving the day? Does he even try to lean it that way? Or is he an agnostic leaning towards atheism, saying the decaying church in Denmark is too heavy on the Christian values and nobody believes it anymore, and here's the harm in believing it? Although it can have a slightly good side, it doesn't exist because these guys believe in it. It doesn't exist because you can't get it on camera, and it doesn't exist because, really, these movies are telling us no one's ever sensory perceived with their eyes or ears or anything the true voice of God. Except in Ordet, where this guy thinks he is, and we all know he can't be because Carl Dreyer's directing. And if anyone's God, it's Carl Dreyer, right? So we pray to Carl Dreyer, and we ask all these things. Amen. Goodbye, I'll see you next masterclass. It'll be in a few days, 3-4 days. I love you to all my students. I hope you come back. It's Dr. Sheely, Film Criticism 405, Coursera Harvard, YouTube Masterclass, USC CalArts. We'll be back. We'll be banking on some good theories. We'll talk about some more uplifting color films or something to get back in the pattern of humor, because Dreyer, although he does have an occasional joke, just invents the style of humorlessness, whether it's transcendent or not. And the fact that there's not a joke doesn't mean like there seems like there would have been otherwise, except in the movie Vampyr, but that's for another day. Goodbye, my class.